MedCram.com.
Welcome to another MedCram COVID-19 update. In the United States, daily new cases are leveling off. But actually, in places like California, it is actually decreasing. Whereas in Wisconsin, it seems to be taking off. Of course, the big news is that in Europe, cases are accelerating. Here is the graph for the United Kingdom, almost reaching the same levels as they did at the beginning in March and April. In France, they're easily surpassing the limits that they set back in March and April. Similarly, Spain also saw a big increase, but is now tapering off. Whereas with Italy, we're not seeing the huge increase in some of the other countries of Europe, but nevertheless also an increase. And so as a result of this, we're seeing that the government in Great Britain is making some rules that will be closing down pubs and restaurants to have 10 p.m. closing times. The BBC is reporting that the UK's COVID-19 alert was moved up to level 4, which is the second highest level, and basically means that the transmission is high or rising exponentially. And the Prime Minister is expected to stress the need for people to follow social distancing, wearing face coverings, and washing their hands regularly. And government forecasts warn that there could be 50,000 new coronavirus cases a day by mid-October. That's in just about a month, if no further action was taken. And it's related to exponential growth. To really understand exponential growth, you actually have to think about it in a different way. And this is a great website, moderndollar.com. And it really raises the understanding about what exponential growth is and why this virus is so dangerous if left to multiply. So the question is, would you rather have a penny every day that doubles for 30 days for a full month? So in other words, the first day you get a penny, the second day you get 2 pennies, the third day you get 4 pennies, and then 8 pennies, etc., for a month. And whatever you have at the end of that month is what you get. Or would you rather have $1 million? Well, what this website shows is that a penny doubled for 30 days, so it's actually going to be close to $11 million on that last day. But the point that I want to make is that most of that growth happens at the end of those 30 days. In fact, you could go more than halfway into that month and still say, wow, I should have taken $1 million. And that's exactly what people may think now is, we don't see this virus very often. Problem is if you wait, it's going to be very hard to contain at the end. And this is the issue with exponential growth. Our minds are not designed to think in terms of exponential growth. The way that we supply hospitals is in a linear fashion, not an exponential fashion. And so when you understand the power of exponents and how fast a virus can spread, that's when you start to be cognizant of why it is that if you start to see something growing, it's going to grow very, very slowly at first. And then toward the end, it's going to grow extremely rapidly. Again, notice where we start to see and detect this massive amount of income here towards the end of the month. But it started way back here. And that's why, for some of us, it's not hard to believe that the virus may have been around for months prior to detection, because it's growing so slowly at these low levels. So currently, Europe is in the throes in terms of increased viral replication among its population. And we can speculate as to why that is. Kids going back to school, bars and restaurants opening late, people not wearing masks. The bottom line is the current situation is not sustainable. And that's why governments in Europe are feeling like they need to do something to curb the curve. And that's something that a collective population has to do. The question is what can an individual do to prevent themselves from getting the SARS-CoV-2 virus? And what is the data that supports it? Those that have followed our updates will know that we've stressed the importance of sleep and stress reduction. Now, we don't have data yet specifically for these things in COVID-19, but we do have data, really good data, that shows that it works in other diseases. Now, it's interesting that Dr. Fauci, in an interview with Jennifer Gardner, agreed with some of these things. For instance, he himself takes vitamin C and vitamin D. He recommends getting a good night's sleep and stress reduction. And if you want to see this interview, we'll leave the link in the description below. So for you MedCram listeners, a lot of this is not news. It's good to know that the leaders of our country are coming around to the idea that there are things that we can do to help our immune system deal better with COVID-19. But the question is begged, yes, these are things that we can do to enhance our immune system. But is there behavior that we are engaging in that is unnecessarily exposing us to the virus? And if there is, what are the risks of that behavior? And what are the particular behaviors that we can avoid so that we reduce our chances of being exposed to the virus? Well, this is a great report here that we'll link to, and it is put out by the CDC. It's titled Community and Close Contact Exposures Associated with COVID-19 Among Symptomatic Adults Greater Than 18 Years of Age in 11 Outpatient Healthcare Facilities. Now, the first thing you've got to understand is that this is not a randomized placebo-controlled trial. This is a case-controlled trial. And so there are areas here where you can get confounders, where basically association does not mean causation. So we can't say that this causes it, but we can say that this type of behavior is associated with a positive test. So here we have in the left-hand column the case patients. These are people that came in with symptoms and tested positive for SARS-CoV-2 virus. The positives are the case patients, and the negatives are the control participants. And you can see here that those N numbers are about the same. Now, where they are statistically different, we get p-values of less than 0.05. And so what they're saying here is that age probably doesn't make a huge difference in terms of who gets it. Certainly men versus women, no statistical significant difference. And you can see here as this goes down the line, now they do the evaluations of all of this. And what they do is they graph it out quite nicely here in terms of the adjusted odds ratio and the 95% confidence intervals for community exposures, which were associated with confirmed COVID-19 among symptomatic adults age greater than 18. So for those of you who are not statisticians, what we're looking for is in each one of these, the dot is basically the average or the mean. And these brackets show in 95% confidence where the actual value would lie. And if you want to see something that is truly associated with the disease, you want the brackets to be on the right side of this dotted line. This dotted line is an odds ratio of 1. So if something has an adjusted odds ratio of 1, that means there is no difference. So clearly here, there is this one here makes the cut because there is an average and the brackets are fully on the right side of this line. So going to a restaurant, in other words, is statistically significantly associated with getting a positive COVID-19 test. Now, we can't say strictly that going to the restaurant caused the COVID-19 test, but it's certainly possible that this could be there. Why? Because this is one of the indoor places where people generally are not wearing a mask, because that's the only way they can eat or drink whatever it is that they're going to the restaurant for. Now, one weakness of this study was that they didn't check if the patients or the subjects were dining outside or inside. As you can see here, the office setting was not associated. Going to a salon was not associated. Could very well be because you can wear a mask in this setting. A home with greater than 10 persons, not associated with it. Going to a gym, you can see there was a wide range, but because that 95% confidence interval is on the other side of the unity of 1, we can't necessarily say that it is statistically significant. Public transportation as well straddles that 1 dashed line. Going to a bar or a coffee shop, here in the light blue or the purple, it is statistically significant. However, in the dark blue, it doesn't meet statistical significance. And so we can say the blue is the adjusted odds ratio, but the light blue is the adjusted odds ratio among the subset with no close COVID-19 contacts. So among those people who have no close COVID-19 contacts, going to a bar or a coffee shop was statistically significantly associated with getting a positive COVID-19 test. Here with a church or religious gathering, again, it's very broad and wide, but it is not statistically significant because it does cross the line of unity. So this caused the authors to conclude that in this investigation, participants with and without COVID-19 reported generally similar community exposures, except for those two that we saw, those going to locations with on-site eating and drinking options. It goes on to say that adults with confirmed COVID-19 were approximately twice as likely as were control patients to have reported dining at a restaurant in the 14 days before becoming ill. Now, there's a lot that we don't know about indoor spread, but there's this interesting article here that has not yet been published, but is part of the medical archive that shows that when they looked at contact tracing in Japan, they were able to see that the number of secondary cases, those that were generated by each primary case, when they looked at the odds ratio, it showed that those primary cases that transmitted COVID-19 in an enclosed environment was 18.7 times greater compared to an open air environment. Another way of saying that is, if you look at this contact tracing, that the chances of picking up COVID-19 was almost 19 times less outside a closed environment. So we try to support our local restaurants, especially if they have a place to eat outside. And I can tell you, living in Southern California, that's almost exclusively where you have to go to eat. We can do all the things that we can to enhance our immunity, but we can also try to find the riskiest behaviors and refrain from those type of behaviors. I think we're going to have a lot more to say about this in terms of where this pandemic is headed to, especially in Europe at this point. Look for more updates here from MedCram.
And don't forget to see all of our MedCram videos at our website, medcram.com. We'll see you next time.